begin, children, with a new lesson in chemistry today, metals and non-metals. Now, whenever the word metal comes to our mind, children, we think of things such as gold, something which is made up of silver, iron, copper. These are all terms to be metals. And when it comes to non-metals, children, the air, take a deep breath. The air that you have taken in is oxygen, that is a non-metal, children. Then hydrogen, it's a non-metal, or basically you can say, children, hydrogen is also a gas, right? Oxygen is also a form of a gas. Then chlorine is a gas. So children, different metals and non-metals are that which we keep on using in our day-to-day life. And this is a chapter in which we are going to study about them in detail. So let's get started. A typical metal is characterized by its shine. You know, metals shine, children. They are tough, that means they are very, very strong. And strong feel. When you touch them, you can feel that they are very strong. In ancient times, people knew only 8 metals. Earlier, people were only aware that they thought that there are only 8 metals, which were gold, silver, copper, tin, lead, iron, quicksilver, which is known as mercury, and antimony. But today, the picture is different, children. Today, about more than 80 metals are known to man. Rest of the elements are non-metals, and some are also metalloids. You know, the metalloids is a group of elements, children, that have some properties of metals and they share some properties of the non-metals. These metalloids show the characteristics of both metals and non-metals. They mostly act as a semiconducting element. Some examples of the metalloids given over here are, children, boron, silicon, germanium, arsenic, antimony, and terulium. Metals have thousands of uses in our day-to-day life. Now, there are many, many uses that metals serve in our daily life. Often, they are mixed or combined with the other metals also. When they are mixed, children, when metals are mixed with the other metals to form something more useful than that combination of these metals, that's a mixture that is formed, is known as an alloy. So what is an alloy, children? Alloy is a homogeneous mixture of the different metals and sometimes even of the non-metals used together. Almost any machine or device has at least one metal in it. The most widely used metal is iron. You know, out of all the elements, the metals that we are using, children, iron is the most popular one. Why? Because it is quite cheap, it is readily available, and it has a lot of tensile strength. That means it is very, very tough and strong. But not in its purest form, right? Not in its pure form it is used. Now then, how is iron used, children? Iron is combined with small amounts of the other non-metals, such as carbon, to form a group of alloy which is known as steel. Now in your home, you must be having many utensils, the cutleries and all that are made up of steel. So steel is a form of alloy, children, that is made by mixing iron with carbon. Making alloys are extremely important in industries these days. Often alloy of a metal are harder and stronger than the pure metal itself. And this science of metal is known as metallurgy. Now children, you must have seen your mothers wearing a lot of jewelry that is made up of gold. Now the jewelry that they wear is not made up of pure gold, but it is made up of an alloy of gold. Why? Because pure gold doesn't have a lot of strength. So in order to make it more durable, while they are wearing it, doesn't get broken down easily. So the other elements are mixed into it. That is known as the alloy. Sometimes silver or copper is being mixed. Although the majority of elements in the periodic table are metals, many non-metals are also found in our nature. Like I told you, oxygen, children. Oxygen is the gas that you are breathing in, right? So that is a non-metal. The non-metal oxygen and nitrogen make 99% of the Earth's atmosphere. You know, children, the presence of nitrogen is how much and the percentage of oxygen in the atmosphere is how much, right? So both these gases, they make up most of the atmosphere and they are both non-metal. Carbon, being another non-metal, is found in more compounds than all other elements in combined forms. Even carbon is found in our earth, children, in abundance. It is combined, it is found in the form of a combined state with many elements. You have so many combinations of carbon, so many substances that are found that contain carbon in it, that there is a separate branch of chemistry, children, in which we only read about the the compounds that are formed by carbon. Most non-metals don't conduct electricity, are much poorer conductors of heat than metals, and are brittle when solid. Brittle means something which will break easily, like glass, that is brittle. Metals through history. Now let's see what is the history of the metals. One of the earliest alloy was bronze. The first alloy that was made was bronze, which is a mixture of copper and tin. It has been known for thousands of years and was the first widely used substance for making tools after the rocks and the stones. After human beings started civilizing, they were first using the various tools that were made up of rocks or stones, and after that they started using the tools that were made up of an alloy which was bronze. Brass is another common alloy of copper and zinc. Perhaps the most famous metal is gold. It has been valued since the ancient time as it stays bright and shiny and has an inert nature. Now you know gold, children, it has a very nice color, the golden color of it. It is bright, it shines, and it does not get tarnished or corroded easily. It stays the same for a very long period of time. That means it has an inert nature, and that is why the jewelry is made up of gold or silver. Coming to the next thing, children, the occurrence of metals. Where are they found? Most of the metals do not exist in their native or free state. They are usually found in the rocks in combined forms. Now these metals, children, they are taken out from below the surface of the earth, and they are found embedded in the rocks. And the rock that contains a lot of metal is known as the ore of that metal. Only the unreactive metals are found in free state. Now those elements that do not react, they will be found in a free state. But the metals that are very, very reactive, they always combine with whatever mineral is there near to them. Metals cannot be extracted from all the minerals. Rocks, now this is what I was telling you, ores right now, children. Rocks that contain metal or metal compounds from which it can be economically taken out or extracted is known as the ore of that metal. Now means what, children? Now if we talk about a big piece of a rock, and from that if we get a very less amount, a meager amount of the metal, then we can't call it as the ore of that metal. Why? Because you will waste, or the government waste a lot of money, or when the extraction is being done, a lot of money, resource and energy gets wasted in that. So that cannot be called as a ore. But if a lot of, from that piece of rock, a lot of mineral, a lot of metal can be extracted, then only we give it a name as the ore of a particular metal. Now here is the table in your book, children, which has the name of the ore, right? The type of the ore, that is the oxide ores, the name, their chemical formula, and which metal is extracted from them. Now this is a very, very important table, children, because this table you will also, if you learn it and mug it up in your class 7, you will be able to remember it and use it in your higher classes also. So this is a very important table. You can take time for learning it, but make sure that you know it and you learn it. When we talk about oxide ore, children, zincite. Oxide ores means they contain oxygen. Now look at the formula, all of them have oxygen in it. Zincite, ZNO, zinc oxide. Hematite, Fe2O3, now with iron oxygen is there. Magnetite, again iron and oxygen is there. So what will be extracted from this hematite and magnetite? Iron. And what will be extracted from zincite, children? Zinc. So this way this table is given, which is very important for you to learn and to revise and to know it. Similarly, children, we have the carbonate ores. Now carbonate means carbonate group is CO3. Now calamine, if you see, that is ZnCO3. Limestone is CaCO3. Now from ZnCO3, which metal will be extracted? Obviously zinc. And from calcium carbonate, what will be extracted? Calcium. So this way the table is to be done. Next is, children, some important terms that are related to elements. First is luster. Luster means, children, the shine. The property to reflect light and hence appear shining is known as luster. Metals shine. Now look at it. I'm using a graphite pencil right now. And the tip of it, you can see it shining. See? Can you see it shining, children? Right? So that is known as shine. Now graphite, you must be wondering, children, being a non-metal, still it shines. Example, the steel plate shines when exposed to sunlight. Malleability is a property of metal, children, that can be beaten into thin sheets. Now the aluminium foil that you use, your mothers use for wrapping your food stuff in your tiffin boxes, children, that aluminium is actually a metal. So that aluminium has a property, children, that how much it is being beaten, it will not break, but it will keep on spreading out in the form of thin sheets. Though it is done with the help of machines, that is why you get a uniform thin sheets. So this property of metals is known as malleability. Next is ductility. The wires, children, when the wires are being made, so inside the plastic covering, thin wires are there. Long thin wires are there, which are used for making the cables. So copper cables are there, aluminium cables are there. Right, so this property of the metals to be drawn into wire is known as ductility. Next is electric conductivity. Now metals are, children, they are good conductors of electricity. That means easily they will help the electricity to move through them. The quality of electricity transmitted by a unit area and unit time under a unit potential difference. That means they easily let the electricity pass through it. Tensile strength, the property by which metals can resist the pulling action. It also depicts the strength of the metal. That means how strong the metal is, children. Will it break easily? When it is carrying some load, will it break down? So that is known as tensile strength. Hardness, the property by which metals can resist cutting, scratching or grinding is known as hardness. How hard the metal is. Suppose you try to cut it. Will it get cut easily with a knife? If you are trying to grind it, will it get easily grinded up? So that is what is known as its hardness. Depends upon how much is the intermolecular space between them and how much is the intermolecular force of attraction. Next is, children, sonority. The property of producing the sound when they are being struck is known as sonority. Sound is produced when a steel bowl is struck with a spoon. Now hear this, children, when the steel bowl is being struck with a spoon. So this is known as sonority. Now when you try the same thing with non-metal, children, you will see this sound will not be produced. Brittle, the property by which a substance can easily be broken into the powdered state is known as brittle, like the glass. The moment you leave a glass utensil from your hand, or maybe a glass breaks or it falls down, you will see it will shatter and break into pieces. So that is the brittle. Last one is, children, no, the ninth one is electropositive nature. The property by which the element will lose electrons to form the positive ions is known as electropositive nature. Now, children, metals generally have the electrons that are there in the outer shell, which are maybe 1, 2 or 3. So always whenever the metals are forming the compounds, they come together in a combination in a reaction, children, they tend to lose their electrons. And when they lose their electrons, the negative ions, they get decreased and the positive number increases. Now, when the positive number increases and the negative number decreases, they are termed to be positive ions. Now, this is actually what happens to them. I have taken an example of sodium atom. Now, the atomic number of sodium atom is 11. So, the number of electrons are also 11, children. The number of protons are also 11. Now, electrons will be written as 11 negative and protons will be written as 11 positive, children. Now, both of them cancel each other. Therefore, sodium atom is neutral. It doesn't have any charge over here. It's neutral. Now, let's talk about why they are called electropositive. Now, whenever the sodium will come into any kind of a reaction, then what will it do is, it will try to donate the electrons. Now, over here in a sodium ion, children, the number of electrons are 10 and the number of protons are still 11. Whenever they come in a reaction, it is the electrons that transfer, not the protons. So, the protons are still the 11. Now, the negative charge on a sodium ion is 10 negative and the positive is 11 positive. Now, according to maths, if you see, children, what is increasing? A plus 1 is increasing, and that plus 1 is actually what is written over here. Or this 1 also signifies that it has given away its one electron. And so this is known as a positive ion. So the same thing is given over here, children, what I explained you right now. This is a sodium atom and this is a sodium ion. Similarly, children, the electronegative nature. Now the non-metals, children, always have a tendency of gaining the electrons. Because in the outermost shell, they have five, six or seven electrons. So they always have a tendency of gaining. So when they gain, the negative ions increase, the number of electrons increase. So that is why the non-metals are known as electronegative and they are said to have electronegative.